our responsibility in spiritual warfare. Dr. Hamlet, 5:95. Ephesians 6:10-18, Romans 13:12-14. Amen.
Amen.
Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might.
Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil.
For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against power, against the ruler of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places.
Wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand.
Stand, therefore, having the loins girded about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness.
And your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace.
Above all, taking the shield of faith wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked.
And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God.
Praying always with prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints.
The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light.
Let us walk honestly as in the day, not in routing, drunkenness, not in gambling, and wantonness, not in strife and envy.
But put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof.
Give you all the praise, the glory, and the honor, Heavenly Father. Father, we just come to say thank you, Heavenly Father.
Thank you.
For just watching over us, bringing us up to this point, Heavenly Father.
Yes, Heavenly
Father, we thank you for your plan of salvation, Heavenly
thank
Father.
You, thank you, Father.
And all that have taken place, Heavenly Father, to make it come through, Heavenly Father. Father, we just thank you, Heavenly Father. Father, we ask that you would just bless our revival week, Heavenly Father.
Yes.
We ask that you would use each and every one that's part of it, Heavenly Father. We ask a special blessing for the minister, Father, that's going to bring forth the word, Heavenly Father.
Yes.
So, Father, this time, Father, we ask that you would search our hearts and search our minds, Heavenly Father.
Yes.
Anything that would stand in the way of us receiving your word, Heavenly Father. Anything that stands in the way, Heavenly Father, of receiving your blessing, Heavenly Father. We ask that you will cast it out, Heavenly Father. Anything that runs through our mind that won't let us stay focused, Father, we ask that you will remove it, Heavenly Father. Father, we ask that you will just open our hearts and use it as a sponge that we may absorb your word this afternoon, Heavenly Father.
Yes.
That we may take on your word, Heavenly Father.
Yes.
That our cup may be filled, Heavenly Father. That we may be revived tonight, Heavenly Father. That you may be lifted up, Heavenly Father. Use us in a special way, Heavenly Father, that your will may be done, Heavenly Father, that we can go out and help somebody what we're supposed to do, Father, that we may go out and share your word, Heavenly Father, going to this old sinful world and tell them that there is hope, there is hope, there is joy, there is peace, there is happiness. You don't have to live with your head and out of control, but there's hope and victory in Jesus Christ, Heavenly Father. Use us, Heavenly Father, that we may tell your children, Father, your children, those that you created, those that you put on this earth, Father, that's lost and don't know which way to go. Use us that we may touch them, Heavenly Father, that we may touch our family members, Heavenly Father. Father, we need your blessings tonight, Heavenly Father. So we ask that you would just bless the minister, Father. Whether he's weary or tired, Heavenly Father, we ask that you would just cast it out, Father. But we ask you to just pour down your spirit on him, Father, that he's ready to run the marathon, that he's ready to run the race, Heavenly Father. Use it this morning that he can shout from the bottom of his soul, that he can just be used by you, Heavenly Father, that we may, that you may be lifted up, Father, and we may hear what we need to hear, Father. So, Father, we ask that you would just bless us this night, Heavenly Father. And just use us, Father. We may be an instrument for you, Heavenly Father. You may receive all the glory and the honor, Heavenly Father. These and all other blessings we ask in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Frankenstein.
Praise the Lord. Thank you for that message in the song. We come to the time of our offering, and as we prepare to take our offering, let's remember offering time is not a social time. We do it reverently. We do it as unto the Lord. We ask all of you, if you would please give as generously and as liberally as you possibly can. The work of our revival this time. Our young deacon and his dressed down clothes is coming to receive the regular offering. Amen. I know he gives of his best, so I'm not going to give my will take care. I'll share the pastor. Shall I render unto the Lord for all his benefits toward me? I will take the cup of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows unto the Lord now in the presence of all his people. Give, and it shall be given unto you. Good measure. Press down, shaken together, and my note shall be given into your bosom. Same measure with which you measure, same shall be measured to you again. He who sows sparingly shall reap also sparingly. He who sows bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Every man as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly, nor of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. Let's all stand. Jarrell leads us in our altar prayer.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this offering, Lord. May you touch it, Lord. Let me use it the way you see fit, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Bless the people that gave, the ones that did, man, and had the heart to, Lord. So just bless us, we ask for this precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. All thanks. Preaching and teaching,
yes,
of the Word of God. Dr. Sadler is a well-known and, I'm not exaggerating when I say, world-traveled preacher. He has preached in Africa, I know, and we can probably say that he's preached on several continents. We just thank God that he counts it not robbery, to come here to New Jerusalem and to share with us doing our revival. And I kind of claim ownership on him because I knew him when he was a student and I saw him when he was a diamond in the rough. So I put early claims on him. I preach about Jesus getting up early in the morning, I put early clean on. it wasn't a hard thing to do because he showed much promise from the very beginning, and he has not disappointed. He serves as the pastor of the New Morning Star Baptist Church, where he has been for the past 20 plus years. He is a faithful husband and a father, he is a lover of God and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So without any further ado, after we have this next selection from the choir, the next voice that we will hear will be that of our revivalist, Reverend Dr. Donald K. Sadler. Sister Henderson looked surprised. Like she hadn't been paying attention to the program. That was a selection program. So maybe she wants to come sing a solo.
No, you don't want to do it. Okay, I'll.
And so after this next selection, the next voice that we will hear, Dr. Sadler, we ask you to please receive him prayerfully.
She's not the only one that's not paying attention. Amen to God be the glory.
Amen. All the pictures.
And they did teach me how to read.
Jesus, save me,
blessed, all praise.
Let her say amen.
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 Amen. We greet you with Jesus' joy.
Amen.
We magnify his presence here tonight.
Amen.
Holy Spirit.
To your honor and esteemed pastor, to Mr. Campbell, to your lovely First Lady, and to all of the officers, members, and friends. We are certainly happy to accept this invitation to come back and share with you on your revival. And we certainly want to say a word of encouragement and commendation to you for having a revival.
Holy Spirit.
And certainly move things, but one of the things that needs to continue to be in the church is the revival.
Amen.
Certainly happy to see with us tonight the Anthony family, Deacon Anthony.
As well. Amen. Amen. Bless the Lord. Amen.
And we pray your strength in the Lord. Pray for me as we prepare to go through the week, that the Lord will keep me strong, and that the Lord will send the message that you need here at New Jerusalem Baptist Church.
That's Lord. That's
amen.
Lord. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Pray for our world. We're living in an awful time.
Well,
yes,
Lord.
Yes,
well, Lord.
Yes.
But God will prevail.
Yes, yes,
he will. Amen. We want to, a lot of preliminaries, but we certainly always impressed by Pastor Henderson and his leadership our city, and how he certainly embraces the Baptist faith.
Holy Spirit.
One of our pastors said when Dr. Fowler went to sleep, that, and it was so true, how that Dr. Fowler always made you feel safe in his presence because of his stance and his position. And Pastor Henderson is following in those footsteps.
And, that's
Lord.
We need, that's Lord. That's
we need Lord. Persons that are banners for the kingdom of heaven.
Father God.
We know that we'll not take down in a day and a time like this. Amen. Thank you for your volume tonight. I was just thinking how Pastor Henderson was talking about it, and I had my first time to participate in revival right here at New Jerusalem Baptist Church some years ago while in seminary. And I remember getting off work and taking a nap in the car outside. Amen. Waiting for a service to start. So thank you for embracing me here tonight. But I was thinking about how I have matured in faith.
Amen.
We were talking about the sinuses, and some years ago, we make some mistakes in giving the devil too much credit.
Amen.
And sometimes people say things like, you know, that's so slew foot in my throat. No, there's some pollen in my throat.
Amen. Well,
amen.
Well,
we want to give God some credit where it is due.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But there are two passages of scripture I want you to look at tonight. Turn to Psalm 68, verse 18. And also in the New Testament, you would find Ephesians chapter 4, verse 7. Psalm 68, 18. And Ephesians chapter 4, verse 7. We'll begin reading first in Psalm 68, the 18th verse, and it reads as follows. Thou hast ascended on high. Thou hast led captivity captive. Thou hast received gifts for men, yea, for the rebellious also, that the Lord God might dwell among them. This is a reading of Psalm 68:18. And for your spiritual edification in the 17th beginning at verse 7 of chapter 4 of Ephesians. It reads this way. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ.
Yes.
Wherefore he saith, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Now that he ascended, what is it but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? Verse 10, he that descended is the same also that ascended up far above the heavens, that he might fill all things. Thus ends the reading of God's word. Make a note for tonight. Our subject is rescue, recovery, residue, and residual. Rescue, recovery, residue, and residual. Let us pray. Eternal and everlasting God, our Father, we thank you for your divine presence among us. We feel your spirit move in every heart that we may be touching and agreeing on the same thing. Lift up your word, Father, that it may bring motivation to us, that we may fulfill what your desire is for the kingdom. This we ask in your name, and for your sake we pray. Amen.
Amen.
As we come together on this post-Easter Resurrection Sunday week, we find ourselves marveled again by the resurrection of our Christ, who has conquered death. Paul gives us that passage that asks the question, O grave, where is your victory? As death, where is its sting? We have recovered from the dominion of death and the grave. We as Christian folk ought to celebrate because there was a time that we were on the other side of this Easter experience.
Lord have mercy.
And we are excited about Jesus, who has delivered each and every one of us. As we give our testimonies day to day, we ought to all boast that we are a living testimony.
Yes.
Even if you can't articulate it, put it in words, a paragraphical form, you know just because you walked in the building tonight that you are a living testimony. You know because there's breath in your body that you are a living testimony. Many of us can do a lot of things. Some of us can't, you know, cook like some of the chefs and bake barbecue ribs, but at least most of us can even cook toast or bolognese. And everything that we do it by the power of Almighty God.
Amen.
It is Him that is in us and willing us to do His will.
Amen.
So as we find ourselves in this period, the Christian calendar catalogs it as we move from Lent to Easter. We find ourselves after Easter in the period of Pentecost, when we remember how Jesus left the Holy Spirit in charge. He told his disciples, and I remember the passage in Matthew when he said that he would send them a comforter and told them that they should remain in Jerusalem.
until we are endowed with power. Pastor Henderson talked about coming and being a part of the testimonial service. Wow. I was blessed myself when I heard a young lady talk about that she has now strength in her witness and testimony. We as a church know that we ought not move that fast trying to be witnesses for Christ Jesus until we are connected with power. We can't do it on our own, but we've got to have power, and we've got to have that power which is from on high. So before we talk about the rescue, the recovery, the residue and residual, we need to know about the rebellion. Because there is a rebellious nature in all of us. And we need to know that Christ himself is the one that's able to remove that rebellion out of all of us. And able to make us soldiers of the Christian cross. There's a rebellious nature because the flesh wants to go back to the dust. Now let me just take my time here. The flesh wants to go back to the dust. And it's going to get its time to go back to the dust. I don't care who you are, you must remember that you're going back to the dust. Maybe a few years, it may be tomorrow, but you're going back to the dust. But what the important thing that we must realize, that we have been called out of darkness into the marvelous light, to be a part of God's blessing plan, and to find out what God has programmed us to do before we go back to the dust. It's about time that we realize what God has planned for us to do in the kingdom of God. So therefore, we must understand that we need the power of God working in us to put the lid on that rebellious nature. There's at least one person trying to go to sleep in here tonight. And that's a sign, that's a sign that we don't have our glorified body. But we fall asleep every night and need the finger of God's love to wake us up every morning. And we need the power of God to give us our directions each and every day. So as we see the beginning of the prophecy that Christ would come and rescue his people began in the Old Testament. You'll remember the stories like Daniel in the lion's den. And you remember how God, the Bible, shares that the lions lost their appetite. Because they were hungry, and God stood in the midst of the lion's den. And the literal 80-year-old Daniel came out unharmed by the power of Almighty God. Because God can rescue you in the nick of time. And that's what we have to go by, the testimonies of those that been rescued. Never forget Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. How they were in the midst of the fiery furnace. You can take and put yourself in the fiery furnace just for a few moments, and I'll drop you in there if you just listen a few seconds, that all of us are in the fiery furnace now in the midst of this presidential campaign race because human beings have been lowered to a level that we have never ever seen before based upon those that want to take the seat in the White House. But you can't ever, ever forget that we are not a part of that political arena, but we are a part of the kingdom of all. Almighty God. And that God is our provider. It is God that takes care of us and gives us our marching orders. So don't get into the rhetoric that you hear day by day, but keep your eyes on the prize. That we've got to continue to stand in the midst of trying and troubling times and telling folk that for God we live and for God that we die. Because God has brought you to this point in your pathway that you are to be a representative of the kingdom of God. You've got to tell men and women that God died that you may have this opportunity to be able to smile even though hell is going on around you. To be able to stand even though financially your life may be a wreck. You may be able to have testimony even though you're in medical diagnosis that make you want to turn and throw in the towel. We know that God is a doctor that has never lost a case. God is a lawyer that's never, ever, ever came out of the courtroom without a victory. And he'll stand on your behalf. You don't have to have any money, but Dr. Jesus will come to your aid. He'll stand there when the going gets tough and when the smoke is clean. God will always be your rescue. He'll be your rescue, so that means that God is a deliverer. And no matter what circumstance you find yourself in, God will rescue you. Now, as we relegate the rescue to those Old Testament stories, and even Jonah, when even he decided that he was going to run away from the presence of God and they threw him off the ship. Even though when the ship decided that they no longer needed him as a passenger and they threw him overboard, even the whale that came by was a rescue. And sometimes you can find yourself in a predicament just like Jonah. I love the story that they said that he had a prayer meeting down there in the bottom of the belly of the fish. And he began to call on the name of the Lord in a way that he's never ever called on him before. And Christians often continue to stay connected to the word of God, because sometimes folk will make you believe that you've done something wrong, that God is mad with you, but he's trying to take you to another level. Jonah says, "Behold, I prayed in the belly of hell." Sometimes you've got to find yourself in a terrible situation to call upon God. Because sometimes we've been praying those Mickey Mouse prayers, those little kid prayers, and God's trying to tell you to get off of "now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep." He's trying to tell you to get off the 23rd Psalm. He's trying to tell you to get on bending knees and stretch out before the Lord and tell the Lord, "I need you in my life. Have mercy on me. I can't live without you." Now, normally in the field that has to do with taking care of those who have been lost and those who have found themselves in a situation where they need someone to come and deliver them from a terrible situation, most of the time when we deal with the rescue, it has to do with the living. And after they get to the point where they feel like the rescue has been aborted, they've gone as far as they can go, next stage is there is and needs to be a recovery. Recovery means that no one possibly could have survived this situation, so there needs to be a recovery to bring the remains of the deceased back back to their loved ones and their family.
Give
identification to those who have expired.
Yeah.
But there's something about those of us who are part of the body of Christ, even though folk have written you off and have said that you are doomed to die, that you are dead and stinking. We're in the New Testament now. When we look at Lazarus down in John chapter 11, it was beyond rescue. It was now a recovery. Because they said he had been dead for 3 years and he was stinking, and it was just time to go on and grieve and eat chicken and remember our friend Lazarus. But whenever Jesus steps into the picture, a rescue recoverer can turn around, because when God get in the middle of anything, God loves to show up, and when God shows up, he will show out. Now, I'm so glad that when he goes down to the grave, there were those, and I'm trying to help you, let me just put a pin in this for a second. Whenever you're going through your situation, and it's a rescue recovery mission, has to do with your soul, your family, has to do with your spirituality, you ought to keep folk out of your business. Because as they make their way down to the grave, there were those that told Jesus, leave it alone. He's been dead too long. There's nothing we can do right now. So you ought not take your advice to those that don't have any power, don't know what the authority of God is, but you have to keep your faith in he that is able to keep you from falling. So he goes down to the grave. As he goes to the grave, because the Bible in Psalm 68 said that he was going to rescue and recover an entire generation of people. And the dead began to think that this was time for Jesus to call their name. But at this particular time, he only called the name of Lazarus. You ain't feeling me right now. Somebody ought to shout right now, because God is a personal Savior. When he saved me, he didn't save you. And God will call your name because he's a personal Savior. I don't know what your name is tonight. Your name may be Jane, maybe John, maybe Ralph, maybe Sam. But when God calls your name, you ought to answer his call. Because God is able to deliver. He can rescue. He can recover. And when God calls your name, this is the thing I like about the story. That they said Lazarus was sick unto death. But when he called him out of the grave, Lazarus wasn't sick no more. I don't know what he had. Might have been cancer. Might have been, I don't know what it was, but he wasn't sick no more. When God called your name, he'll clean it all up at the same time. I hear a lot of folks talk about, I can't get off of cigarettes. Can't stop drinking liquor. I can't get off of narcotics. All you got to do is put it in the name of Jesus. And he'll call your name, and he'll deliver you from everything at the same time. He can put AA out of business. He can throw Nana aside when he call your name. I'm telling you, he only have to do it one time. One time. One time.
Yes,
make me sing every time you look up and fall off the wagon. And then they come and join the church. I know you got a record book in here. That some folk don't join the church about 10, 12, 11, 13 times in their life. But they come and they give them the hand to the preacher, but never give them their heart. But if you open up your heart and let Jesus come in, let the way out of no way come in your heart, let the eyes to the blind come in your heart, that the water that it never runs dry, come into your heart. He told the woman at the well, he said, if you get a drink of this water, you'll never ever thirst again. All you gotta do is get a sip of this water, and you'll never thirst again. Look, I'm happy now.
Yes.
I spoke clear now. I'm happy now.
All right.
I'm about ready to worship now. Y'all ready to worship now? Because God can tell you that he can rescue you. God can deliver you. And he can fix you up.
Watch this. As we see in the New Testament that what was proclaimed in the Old Testament, that he was going to what they call into the bottomless pit. And he was going there, and this is the back room of the death, burial, and resurrection. That he was going to lead captivity captive.
Yes, sir.
He had already had a practice on Mount Lazarus. But for generations and generations, there were those in the Old Testament that said there were those who died with manna in their minds. They had not had the rescue and recovery of Jesus Christ. But the stain of sin because of the law had locked them into eternal damnation. And they were doomed to die. So that's why they said Satan has railing accusation and is always there when there's ever a spiritual celebration. Satan is always there trying to make sure that your mind is clouded. So as Satan begins to look at Jesus going into the bottomless pit, he begins to release, because the Bible says he has the keys of hell and death. But not only does he have the keys, he has the master key that nobody else has. And he unlocks those that have been held captive forever and a day. And not only did he release them, but the Bible said he gave gifts to all men, and even those that are rebellious. So there's a rebellious stain on the Christian church, even in the New Testament. I'm not going to be long with you tonight. For we come from the rescue to the recovery. Now we come to the residue. There is still a residue left in the body of Christ. So that's why they are squabbling in the church house. That's why there are those that trying to do their own thing. That's why there are those that don't read the word of God. That's why there are those that don't come to choir rehearsal. That's why there are those that don't give their tithes and offerings. That's why there are those that walk away from their wives. That's why there are those that don't feed their children. But that's why there are those that don't call upon the name of God. That's why there are those that think they're more than Almighty God. But God is trying to tell you that even though that residue exists, that God is going to wipe the slate clean, because you are a free moral agent. He's not going to make you do it, but he said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock." I'm not a breaking and entering. That's against the law. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if any man come in, I'll come in and I'll sup with you. And that's what the revival is. There may be some residue going on with you. Somebody here haven't shouted since they joined the church, haven't patted their hand since 10 years ago. God's trying to tell you he's knocking on your door. He wants to come in. He wants to make you love again. He wants to make you live again. He wants to make you whole again. But you gotta let him come into your house. If you let him come into your house, there's some residual that you'll get for your investment in the kingdom. Not only will you live eternally,
eternally with him. When you die in the sky, by and by, when he lights the seven candlesticks, when he holds the seven keys in his hand, you don't have to wait until then, but you can get it tomorrow. You walking on the ride around on the metro, God got the keys to the Lexus if you give him their heart. I'm trying to tell you, you walking around from job to job, he's trying to give you a career if you trust and believe in him, because he died on Friday, stayed in the grave on Saturday night, but on Sunday morning, he got up with your residual, sitting around in the church house, waiting for Oprah to say, you get a car, you get a car. But he gave all of us gifts to some pastors, some evangelists, and to some deacons and trustees. You ought to get what God's got for you. All you got to do is open up your heart. So all you got to do sometimes is open up your mouth. Somebody ought to give God some praise. Has God been good to you? Has he picked you up? Has he placed your feet on solid ground? God is able tonight. He's a way maker. He's a bridge over troubled water. Do you love him tonight? Has he been good to you? On Christ the solid rock I stand. His name is Jesus. And he's wondrous to perform. Plants his footstep on the sea. And he'll ride on every stone. I don't have to worry. I don't have to fret, because he's never ever left me yet. And his name is Jesus. I'm not afraid of him, because he's rescued and recovered me. Even though the residue of sin is hanging around, my God has given me the residuals every day, because I talk like him, walk like him, live like him, because he's my daddy. Can't you tell that he's my father? And he's rich and has houses and land, has the wealth of the world in the palm of his hand. By the permission of this pastor, we stand.
Holy Spirit. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Father. For the first night of revival, as we prepare our hearts to go forward, God has brought a blessing to you tonight. Only thing he wants you to do is to acknowledge his presence in this place. Most of us may be church, but have never accepted Jesus Christ in our heart. We need to do some spring cleaning in our lives. Sweep out the residue of sin, iniquity. Clean those out, that God may bring a fresh breeze into your spirit. Don't you want to feel like Jesus feels? He ever touch you again, send that breeze. He'll make you skip like a schoolboy all over again. God's able. He's able. The thing about it, he told them that Moses gave you a divorce for the hardness of your heart, but I never said it. He said he's married to the backslider. Somebody may be in the midst of the church but have been backsliding, not following the principles and the practices of the Word of God. If you're here tonight, we invite any new convert to come. If you've never ever accepted Christ Jesus and been baptized into the faith and accepted him according to Romans chapter 10 verse 9. Confess with your mouth, believe in your heart that Jesus Christ was raised from the dead. But then, you may have done all of that, but you need that fresh spirit to come into your heart tonight. You can ask God for forgiveness. That's all you got to do. Ask God for forgiveness. As we listen to an invitational selection, we invite you to come. Man, woman, boy, or girl. Any way the Baptist will accept you tonight. Won't you heed to the word of God tonight through his power in his presence? He's calling, that's right. This day, for the Bible says, the day that you hear my voice, harden not your heart. Yeah.
or their membership, whatever category.
Dr. Sadler, I'd be saying, man, where you gonna go from here? Mm-hmm. He took us to the mountaintop tonight.
Yes, he
poured out himself so that I was exhausted. Amen. Thank you, Pastor Sadler.
Our
souls have truly been blessed here tonight.
Yes.
I hope, New Jerusalem, you were listening to what this preacher said. He had the message for us here tonight.
Yes, he did.
He reminded us about our rebellious nature, and he wasn't saying that New Jerusalem is the only rebellious church around, but we in our churches we do have some rebellious nature, and I was reminded that 1 Samuel 23:15, that rebellion is as a sin of witchcraft.
That's right.
Rebellion is as a sin of witchcraft. That stubbornness as iniquity and idolatry. Preacher reminded us of that today. We need to fight against that rebellious nature. Yield yourself, your whole heart. He said, give your whole heart to God.
Yes.
Thank you, Pastor Sadler. Thank you for stirring our spirits.
Yes.
And, New Jerusalem, get out and stir up our members, and stir up our neighbors, and stir up our friends, and stir up our families. Tell them that there is a message of hope that's being preached here at New Jerusalem. And in spite of all the trouble in the world, there's still hope. There's still hope in the church, and that hope is reigning supreme here at New Jerusalem this week. So get out and tell some folks. I heard the testimony of the young lady who was saying how many of our co-workers were sounding so hopeless. They need to be here tonight. They needed to be here tonight. Reminded of that hope. I bet they would have found a bomb here in Gilead. they would have gone home feeling a lot better. Ah, Lord. But let's keep letting our light shine. Let's keep telling the story. Let's come out again on tomorrow night. Let's continue to pray for Pastor Sadler, our revivalist.
Yes.
And God is going to continue to bless us. I didn't think Pastor Sadler preached that long. I'm just looking at the clock and it's 9:20. I'm saying he just got started. Amen. God bless you, Pastor. Thank you, man.
Amen.
The Spirit moved mightily here in this place tonight.
Yes.
He forgot that he was having some breathing problems. And he just preached right on through it. Just. That's it. The breathing problems didn't stand a chance. He steamrolled it. Without any further ado, we're going to stand at this time and come and ask that.